Hello, welcome. What's up? What's today's topic? Working on this scene where you gain your meditation skill. This is like a puzzly dungeon. And you activate these three different fiery switches. And so I want, first of all, to have some kind of indicator for those switches, because right now this is kind of, you know, puzzles you to the point where it's not exactly clear what you're supposed to do. So it'd be nice, I'm gonna put a little tower pillar thing here and here and over here that light up whenever you get those other things. So it should be somewhat hinted at least, of, you know, the progress you've made in this dungeon. Okay, so I'm going to start by making that tower, and then I'm going to work on a scene where there's a cutscene where you see an image of the tower, the big tower, the last dungeon of the game, and that should be, it's meant to build up tension for that last dungeon sooner in the game, basically, so you I don't know, there's more story behind it, it feels like more weighty. The fact that you're getting there. Alright, so I'm going to start with like the pillar image. I think they want these to be about the size of a pillar. Hola! What's up, PX? Yeah, I think maybe this first one is probably a good one to start working with. Okay, I'm gonna name this Switchstone. We don't need it to be destroyed. Things are invincible. Now it's a bit too thick. I want it to be a little more even. All right, now this is kind of shaped like a hexagon. I was imagining these are more like squares. Or rectangles on top, and I want them to kind of have like etches going into them. It's magic, right? Thanks, Dieharders. Okay, so here's some of the little etches. Ooh, that's too much. Yeah, something like this. With more, I guess I wanted to have more etches though. Yeah, a little more. Okay, so I'm gonna add a layer to make it glow. Thanks, Metrius. Okay, we'll see how this all comes together. I need a switch stone tile, so I might as well get the code compiling. Okay, switch stone, and let's get this exported. There's still something wrong with this top bit. It's like maybe that should be a little darker. Switch stone 00. This will be the switch stone glow. And area patterns. We'll need this to. We could create a function for it. Area creation. Okay, so I'm going to create a switch stone entity, and then I'm going to do some logic like add the glow if you have a certain item. But I thought I added something to the entity so you could, it only did, oh yeah, there is. It's for Foes, enemies. Where is Rock Face? I added something so you can have a certain child. Yeah, here it is. Glow. Require item. But I wonder if the require item works for the right switch. Yeah, we might need a switch actually. So we'll get the item type for whatever switch. Item type for Z or for maybe for dungeon key. Yeah, I think it's the key number. K num keys. Let's just say whatever index this one is. Because we're gonna have multiple of these switch stones, and each one of the switch stones is gonna reveal whether a certain switch has been activated. So that needs to be key num num key types plus index. If hero dot gear dot count item is greater than 0, then we add the glow child. Or we could just have the glow and then the switch turns it off. Switch stone render image I could just set its skin. Just set its skin to be glowing. So much easier. Okay, so yeah, instead of switch stone 0 glow 0, we can have oh, damn, never mind. I really do want the glow to actually be an action that runs. All right, shoot. Yeah, okay, so the best way is to do a child entity. So we'll have a child called Glow. And we'll make it fade in and out. Oh, there it is, glow. Okay. So if we don't have the item, the glow won't be there. Okay, now the area pattern for before boss. For the swordless needs three of these pillars, one at the lowest. See, I was looking. Okay, that's good. None of them have a glow. Should all be a little lower. They need to be colored according to the rocks. Oh, same thing with the glow. And why didn't any of them have a glow? Maybe I didn't do that right. Oh, there they go. the hell are they doing randomly at first? They're all like super crazy. Right? Something, well, it's getting there. That was cool how it started. I don't know how it started like that. It like it flickered. I want them to be offset. I want all their glows to be different times. Ooh, how do I do that again? Elapsed. Oh, I know what to do. Okay, so far I could do this. I could do this really quick like this. Now I need an index and I need to set elapsed for the glow action. Or maybe for all actions that are running on the glow. Nah, just we know that this is the only child. We'll go in here, loop over the children, find that child, do offset the glow action based on the index. So we need to find the index first. So the index of each one of these is just like, I'll start from the bottom. Okay, yeah, I'll just get for each of the switch stone tiles. If X, oh, shoot. Ah, damn it, I can't use X. Ah! Okay, I can make a method for this. I could even make it flexible for other tiles. So get tile index for a certain tile type. Give it an X and a Y. What's up, Ishni? All right, man. Hope you have a nice day tomorrow, man. It's going to be a long one, huh? Well, cheers, dude. Yeah, so, oh, we need the area as well. Oh, this is like a... Laters. This is like the 2x2y. Or no, 4x. And okay, so now for each tile. If X equals 4X and Y equals 4Y, break. Otherwise, actually always increase the index and then return the index when we're done. So we're looking for each switch stone tile. If for each one of them, we increase the index. So the first, no, wait, we don't want to increase the index yet. There. So yeah, if you find it on the first one or whatever, that's going to be index 0. Cool. Okay, so now I can use this method here to get the index of this switch style, which switch stone. And now the index should be proper too there. And I want to check if this, I have all these right now. Let's turn off. Well, we'll keep two of them. So two out of these, three of these things should be lit up. And then we'll stagger their glows. And that should be it for this little new tile. This will really help clarify this puzzle. Oh, only one of them's lit, which means I did it wrong. I have switch three, switch one and three. Okay, let's see what these, I need to step through this code. Okay, this is tile x7, y6, which should be the first one, so we should get index 0. We got index 1. The next time, is it 13, 6, what index do we get? 2? And then 10, 3? Oh, this should be index 0. Oh, no, this is index 2? The indexes are wrong, that's for sure. Let's find out why. I messed up probably in this getTileIndex function. Okay, so x is 7, y is 6. This should be the last index. Okay, index is still 0. We've gotten to 10.3. 10.3 would be the first one it should find. And so that should be index 0. The next one it comes to is 7, 6. And it finds it. Finds it at index 1. That was correct. I just did a break inside that and it broke out of. Oh my gosh. Wow. Just found a crazy bug. Oh, only half a screen? Oh. So I just used, I never really foresaw this with the for each tile function. Well, it's not a function, this is just like a little pound define. So it's actually got two loops inside it, and I'm trying to break, and it goes out of one loop but not the other. So I need to write this for each tile smarter. Like it could just do one loop and it would do X, Y, I. Oh, no, wait, this could be even simpler, huh? Just one loop. For in x equals 0, y equals 0. X is less than area dot width, or Y is less than area dot height. Y plus plus and X equals X plus area, or X equals X plus one mod area width. All right, I hope this works. So I just found a way to write X and Y into one loop. Hopefully that works. Kind of crossing my fingers here. Let's find out. Oh, wow. That's kind of wizardrous. Wizardy. That was wizardry. Oh no, that's not right. That's not right at all. All right, we gotta just do this smarter. Because the Y, when you increase the X, you need to go, you basically need to do the Y first. Hopefully But that should have compiled though. Yeah, okay. At least it compiled, so I know we could do it this way. If X plus 1 is equal to area dot width, or hell is greater than, then we want to do y plus equals 1. Otherwise, y plus equals 0. And we only need to track the y. So x equals 0, y equals 0, y is less than area dot height. Let's try that. Right, y is less than area height. Y plus equals, yeah, so the second that x, second the y hits its top value, x has already hit it too. So you don't really care. Y plus equals x plus 1 is greater than or equal to the width, then you would increase the y, and then x plus equals or x equals x plus 1 mod the area width. X and Y in one loop, huh? Not bad. Wait, why is there a slash at the end of that? Doesn't need to be a slash there. We'll see if it worked though. So we got a breakpoint and get switch stone tile. It's the only thing that uses these breakpoints. So we should be good to get test this out. Man, sorry I went into a kind of a code zone here. It's meant to be more of a pixel art stream. Yeah, hopefully. Let's see. Let's see if it works. Index. Right, let's step into this. All right, the first one we find is, oh, that's great. Check, there's a little benefit of that too, is since I ordered X and Y, or both X and Y are created in the first loop, they're in order now. Before it was YX, now it's XY. So it's a lot clearer what's going on when debugging. So that's a cool benefit already for each tile A. Let's see what this is. Let's see what happens when we don't. Okay, so this is index one now. The next time we go through this loop, our x is 10, our y is 3. Oh, it didn't. Yeah, you gotta wait for it to get to the next part of the loop. Nice, right on. Okay, how do I check this? Because I can't really. Oh, I know what I could do. Here, let's just check this the good old way. I'm just going to take that same loop and try it out. Just step through the whole thing and make sure this actually goes right. So, for int, blah, 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 blah. We've got like something here to stop the debugger, basically. Let's try that. Oh, this is A. Oh, we're shadowing the variables here. So, hell, why don't I just do it in this loop? Right, there. There. There! It's there, it's everywhere! Okay, so now I can step through this whole loop, right? And just check and make sure that it does, in fact, quit. Does in fact get to X, Y. Now we're at X20. This is the last position. We go to this next one, and this should go to X0, Y1. Nice. Okay. I hope this is working. Now we need to make sure that if... I'm just going to set a manual breakpoint this time. If X equals 20 and Y equals 19, so it's on the brink, then we set a breakpoint. Just make sure that last bit of the loop works. This is great. X and Y tucked into one loop. Okay, so we're at X20, Y19. We should go up here. And this time we should not get through the loop at all because. Wait. Oh, yeah. Okay. Good. Salad, what's up? It's going good, man. This time I want to see X and Y after the loop. Just to do one last check on this. This is pretty fundamental. Looping over X and Y inside one loop. I want to do this for my other loop too, my for each XY loop, which is just real handy. You know, you don't have to type out the whole loop of loop over all the X and loop over all the Y, because you do. I do it so freaking often, it's like, might as well put a pound to find for that. All right, so it ends up at X0, Y20, which is beyond the end. Yes, it works. Oh, right on. Nice, man. What you getting done? Okay, so this time our indexes should turn out right. And I want to make this work for the, whoops, for each XY as well. There we go. Cool. So that's in one loop. X, Y equals zero. Y is less than height. Y plus equals X is greater than equal one. Or width. 1, 0, X. Okay. Oh, Houseford. Oh, yeah, totally. I definitely prefer programmatic. I really don't like editors. Can't you? I mean, you can in a way, but like, I have to read it first. In those movies and those shows, you know, it's like when you see somebody reading code and they're like, I can see what it's like. They can, really? They can read all that fast? You know, I have to stop and read it and be like, oh, yeah, I can kind of imagine what that would do. Isn't that what most programmers are like? Yes, PX, it is. It's probably more expensive. Yeah, so each one of the loops, it's not too bad. I mean, yes, every time you increment this loop, you're introducing, there's two problems with the performance here. One is that, is there a way to do that without incurring like a performance problem? The modulo operator is not too bad. I mean, I guess it does do a divide. It's almost like a divide. So, or approximately as expensive as a divide, I'm not sure. But the big problem is that it does introduce a branch. But I guess it's not too bad of a problem for modern CPUs and stuff. I really don't think this is going to be too bad. And it's definitely going to be better for debugging. I'm trying to think if I could do it without at least without a branch. Oh, of course I can. Oh, hell yeah, I can make this so much faster right now. If X plus one, or yeah, just make a bool. Y plus equals int out of a bool. There. Now it's like is pretty damn fast. Just about as fast as the other loop would be. Let's do that for area.h2 and then check and make sure it works. Y plus equals int x plus 1 is greater than or equal to area width. There. Yeah, okay. Now I got to make sure this works still. I love it, right? I love abusing the preprocessor. It's so great. Oh, right, totally. Gosh, I know, right? I haven't even thought about the implications of that, but I'm sure it's freaking awesome. Yeah, I'm so looking forward to this. Okay, so I'm gonna test out both these loops too to make sure these both work. Don't tell me I got errors. What? Errors? Oh. God, I always say like I'm just gonna do one little thing before I do this other little thing. I like started the stream off saying I'm gonna draw a cool tower, the tower scene, then I was like, but first, I just want to do this little stone here. I guess it's my MO. Okay, let's test these loops out. Right? it drives me crazy sometimes. Yeah, I know, right? It's nice if I just do the B, C, and D things first. All of a sudden, by the end of the day, you're like, well, I hope I get to A. Hope I get back to point A. Oh, I guess I eventually do. Seems like each day I get back to point A, but not without going through B, C, and D first. What's up with this? Why is it like hanging all of a sudden? Maybe it's, oh, I might have killed it. Oh, you know what? Probably broke something. Yeah, this loop's probably not working. Yeah, right. Intuition. Okay, I think it was hanging because I messed up this loop. Oh wait, no, there it worked this time. Yes, I didn't mess it up. I guess not. Now we're at X20. Y. Zero. So the next iteration of this loop, we should get x0, y1. Yeah. Okay. Right? What's up, Rocket Bunny? So I'm looking for Y19. Here we go. Okay, so this iteration of the loop, it should be done. Wait, what? Oh no, it's just still this Y19. Oh. There we go. Okay, so now we're at X20, Y19, and it should get itself out of the loop, and it does. Very good. Oh, you have? Why? What do you want, man? Wait, what happened to this other loop, though? Oh, I forgot to reset X and Y. Okay, let's make sure that one works too. This is a pretty cool improvement. An XY loop inside one loop. I mean, I guess it's a tiny bit less efficient than a regular XY or two XY loops. I guess, but not counting that you have to create a new stack though. Or I think you have to push back a new stack frame every time you do a new block, right? So, or maybe not. It depends on the compiler, probably. So anyways, there's some situations where this loop might actually be faster than two separate loops, I would think. I guess you are introducing a mod and a comparison and an add and another add right here. Which is, I guess, a lot slower than just incrementing both the variables. But only by a few instructions. We're not talking much at all. Oh, what? There's a school with excellent computer science, huh? Sweet. Okay, let's check those in. Wait, I guess we'll check it on the indexes next and then check in the, let's go through B first, huh? Let's just go through B. Point A will come at some point. First index. X, 7, Y, 6, index 1. 13, 6 is index 2. And 10, 3 is index 0. It worked! It frickin' worked! Oh, nice. Okay, so, and this one's lit up. These other two aren't lit up. What is that? How weird. That's so weird. It's glow sometimes does this weird thing. Oh, what? That sounds awesome. So I'm gonna check in area.h and kit.h. Okay, next step is to get it, so. The glows are correct. Right now, if I turn off all of them, see what happens. Yeah, they're all off. I turn on one of them. Yeah, see there, it didn't work. So I must be looking for the wrong switch or something. Next thing to do is set a breakpoint right after here, after it chooses which item it is. This get tile index function can be really handy. I'm gonna keep it at the top. You have until the 21st, all right. Okay, this is index 1, but switch 3-1. Oh. And then 2 is switch 3-2, and that's key 38. Oh, okay, so that was the problem. This needed to be num key types plus 1 plus index. There, so I've got one of them, which should be the bottom middle. Yeah, the middle one. And I turn on another one, it should be the left one. Nice. Got the little one or the middle one here. Huh. Oh, there you go. Some ammo for your argument. Nice. The left one. Yeah. What? These gloves are messed up. They started correct. I could just do the glow manually. This is just ridiculous. Yeah, that'll make me be able to stagger them easier anyways. I guess I could create a switchstone glow entity and then make it a child. Nah. Nah. Do it this way. Okay, so I've created a sprite. Now I can run an action on it. Oh, and we want to delay some time before this runs, before this becomes visible. What? How did they all get in the same sink? Oh, they need to start all at capacity zero. Delay time index times. How the heck are they settling into exactly the same rhythm? Need to repeat forever here. What? Hold on. If I don't run this at all. Whoa. Fundamental, middle, and superior. Okay, somehow it didn't. Maybe I didn't save that. Oh, I just hadn't saved that file the whole time. That was messing with me. Now this is going to fail because it's only going to do it once. Nice. That was cool though. I like that little rhythm. Okay, so now I can just repeat forever on this one. What? 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 I guess the repeat and the delay don't work. Guess I'll have to do this a different way. This is kind of a janky way to do it. Oh, wait a minute. I got a better way to do this. Instead of schedule once, we'll keep it with the friggin' I. This way, if the entity dies, we don't have to worry about it. Oh, yeah, I hope that worked. Finally, they're staggered. And instead of them fading all the way out, they only go to like, they start all unglowing and then they kind of glow after a minute. Okay, and let's see if it actually works in the context of the level. So I'll turn all these off. And try it. Nice. So if I light that first fire, this pillar opens up. I should take off the meditate though. So now we got two of them lit. Yeah. And this dialogue happens. Great, that works. I can check this in. You like the giant cactus? Right. Okay, so I can check in the switch zone. Yay. And I can move on to my intended project for today, which is to draw this tower scene, which I'm probably not gonna have much time for now, but at least I can get it started. I at least can put a half an hour into getting it started. Okay, and that actually was one of my bugs on my list. I'm gonna check that off my list. Yay for checking bugs off the list. So you're strong like a bear. Yeah. But strong or strong, both of those are funny. Strong, that's a cool word, man. Did you just make that up? That's gonna become like the new internet meme, isn't it? Strong. Is that already a thing? It's already strong. There's lonk. Okay, time to freaking actually do some art, huh? It is? Oh. Oh, yeah. All right. The image I want to work with is. I kind of rough drafted it. Need to make it better. The rough draft needs to be better. Which, where is it? Where is it? Where is it? Get to the chopper. There, scene tower preview. Where is that? Where does it actually run this? Cutscene. Tower preview one. Okay, let's make sure tower preview one, first of all, is okay, it's not there. Find the saves file. Here, tower preview. Flag swordless pattern. Oh. Flags before boss as well. You have to be meditating. Oh, we need all the switches, of course. Well, it's not working at all, I guess, because the other action is overriding it. So let's see, use meditate. Oh yeah, sorry about that. Oh no. What? I do want this to do cutscene sound tower preview. Here. What happens if I just disable this? I'll check. Might run both of them. Oh. What is Windows Query Performance do exactly? What? There we go. So it can work. We see just delay the Oh, it's a take function. Oh. Okay, I can work on the delay part later, but at least I have something now where if I use the meditate, it will show this current cutscene. Now I can just make the cutscene cool. In fact, the first thing to do is just slow it down. Yes, it needs to show the tower, but much slower, like. And okay, it needs less sky. All right, yeah, we can get this going. Scene tower preview. Total duration, like, longer for sure. Just longer. And the scene tower preview. I want it to be more zoomed in on the tower itself. Whoops. Oh, damn it. So. Okay. While that's loading and stuff, I'll be right back. Wow. game show is killing my CPU again today. So I finally wrote these guys, and I was like, hey, here's game show using over 150% of CPU, and it won't ever fix itself. And here's like, I even did all that like reporting on this, whatever, the statistics, open files, ports, I did the, what was that thing you can do, whatever. I sampled the process, sent their support people all the information. They wrote me back and they're like, yeah, sorry, we know you're a paying customer and all, but we don't support your hardware anymore. You don't support my hardware anymore. They don't support my hardware anymore. This is like a 2-year-old laptop. A GDD? What's a GDD? Oh, game design document? Hell no. No, I don't write game design documents ever. I don't like game design documents because I feel like they lock you into certain things. And as you explore a project, as you start developing a project and it starts growing and it starts like surprising you with little things you didn't know, you never would have expected this little surprise. And it's nice to be able to take that surprise in some different direction, something you never expected before. And game design documents are all things that you expect. They're things you use your brain for. And I don't know, I really believe in using the heart, the power of the heart, to guide you through projects and to make things really fun and stuff. Is, you know, you got to turn off your brain in a way. I know, for portability. I know, right? I would switch to OBS, but it has the weird lip sync issue. Okay, so slower, darker, and more zoomed in. Yes, yeah. You have troubles with it too? Like, you don't like game design documents, or what? Or you have the opposite problem, like you love game design documents and can't function without them. That's a crazy opinion. I like it, Salad. You don't know what? Right. Something like this, like where it's basically just silhouetted. It's pretty cool. I'll need to repixel all that, but let's see how this is looking so far. Where did this go? Scene tower preview, of course. Zero. Oh, I could separate out the background layer too. There you go, Hoggy. Yeah. I think just a single mock-up image can be as useful as a game design document. You know what I mean? One single mock-up image says a lot. It says a lot about the perspective of the game, what it's like, the characters, the environment, everything. You can start your whole project just with a single mock-up. You don't need a game design document. Okay, we need to go even slower. Oh, yeah. Oh, like it's fun to create? Totally, it's fun to create. Oh yeah, you can't follow it. Yeah. Right? It's almost like maybe a game design document is useful as just sort of an initial heading for a project, you know? You start off with it and then you just say, you know, to hell with it after a while and just let the pro, you know, once you've got your heading. This isn't going slow enough. Why is it the same speed every time? I'm going to separate these two actions too. There's the movement and the fade in, fade out. And the movement, actually, I want to run on the whole duration. Let's see, the whole flux duration is full of movement. All right, Rocket, see ya. Okay, we got a flux duration. Thirty-two seconds. Okay, and the anim duration though. Flux string. What's flux string? Oh, it's idle animation. Yeah. Right, what is a NIM duration used for besides this? Delay here. I think it's this is more accurate to say flux duration. Minus fade in and minus fade out. And now Hearthstone. Damn card games. Card games. My computer's going like hella slow right now because all the CPU is going to game show for some reason. There. Okay, now it needs to go faster. And I want to separate out these two layers. Maybe this could be a layer too with the clouds. There you go, right on. I'll just save these as two images. And then this one will only be that tall. So I'm just doing some really quick, dirty art here. Just to get a general concept of what this scene is gonna be like and the motion of it is gonna be like. The motion is pretty important, how fast it goes. The parallax to it too, so I wanna add a little bit of parallax to this image. So I'm just dialing in those, you know, the greater concepts here before I go and focus on all the pixeling that will go on here in this big image. Reminds me of ice cream for some reason. Okay, so I want to see if, so this image is 560 tall and this one is 540 tall about. I just want to see if that's enough to create a parallax between the two. Might need to have some more height on the background one so it gets a little bit more parallax going on for the whole duration. Yeah, that was pretty cool. I think maybe a tiny bit more parallax, though, would be nice. Let's try this being 580. I don't know how it just had the pixels for that, but it did. And see if that's enough parallax. And the speed of the scene is pretty important too. So I need to, like, you know, dial in about how long it should be overall. That was kind of too much. Actually, so we went from 560 to 580. Let's try 570. I might even go back to 560 where it was. Forgot to pay attention to the duration though. Okay, this time, pay attention to the duration. Gotta pay attention to remember. Yeah, it's all right. I don't know, I kind of liked it back where it was, though. 560, it's a pretty good start. It was a little more subtle. Okay, and I like the duration, actually, about 12 seconds long, but I want the fade-in to be a lot longer. Maybe a whole 4 seconds long, and a fade-out of, like, 1 second long, and it fades out to black. Oh, that was weird. Okay, so I need to basically time it so it shows that scene and then does the opening of this boss door thing. But also, I'm thinking that maybe needs to be a little bit slower. And this fade in, I didn't like how it faded in. I wanted it to show black behind it. I like the darkness though. There's a good, like, this is supposed to be a dark scene. And so the tone levels are pretty good. Like that color of red and that nice silhouette and everything. It moved a little too far, but that can be fixed. All right, well, there's some stuff to work on tonight. But for now, I gotta say goodbye, give myself some dinner. So I appreciate all you guys. Thanks for chatting with me. Thanks for watching. I appreciate you all. Hope you all have a great evening. And we'll see y'all next time.